This is a 2005 Bentley Continental GT. When this car was new back in 2005, the base price was $161,000 before options, which could easily drive the price to around $200,000. Now, around 10 years later, this one is listed for sale for $55,000. That's right, this is a modern Bentley you can buy for the same price as a well-equipped BMW 3 Series. And it's not just any modern Bentley. This is a $55,000 car with a twin turbocharged 12-cylinder engine that makes 550 horsepower. It does 0 to 60 in 4.7 seconds, and it's just over 50 grand for a freaking Bentley. Today I've borrowed this car from Rancho Santa Fe Autos, a dealership here in the San Diego area that specializes in cool and exotic cars. They have an excellent inventory of all sorts of stuff. It includes Ferraris, Porsches, Aston Martins, but I wanted to check out this because I wanted to know what you get when you buy a used Bentley for the same price as a nice 3 Series. First, a little overview. The Continental GT came out as the entry-level Bentley for the 2004 model year, meaning this one comes from the second year, and that also means that yes, you can probably find one even cheaper, though I don't recommend going too cheap because of reliability concerns. I especially like this one because of this bright blue exterior color and the equally extravagant bright blue interior, although I also like it because it's a 550 horsepower twin turbo rocket ship for 55 grand. So today I'm going to show you around the Continental GT, and I'm going to show you the quirks and features of a 13-year-old used Bentley, and then I'm going to get behind the wheel and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the Continental GT, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also compiled a list of the cheapest used Bentley models currently listed for sale on AutoTrader. Now, I'm going to start with my favorite quirk of this car, and that would be the infotainment system scroll wheel. Now, I know that sounds boring, but hear me out and check this out. The infotainment system isn't touchscreen. It's controlled by these 8 buttons on either side and also this big scroll wheel in the middle. The cool thing about the scroll wheel is it only scrolls as far as it can. Allow me to demonstrate. I'm in the map and I'm zooming in, and you can see the scroll wheel is doing the zooming, but I get to the furthest point that I can zoom in and the scroll wheel will no longer turn. Meanwhile, I turn it to the right to zoom out, and I get to the furthest point out, the furthest I can zoom out, and the scroll wheel stops turning. The scroll wheel will only allow me to turn it as far as that screen's menu allows it to turn. And it isn't just the map. Here's another example. Buried deep inside the infotainment settings, there's a screen that allows you to choose how long you want your headlights to stay on after you turn off the car to provide you with some illumination when you're going into your house at night, whatever. As you can see, if I turn it all the way to the left, I turn it off, and then the scroll wheel stops turning. I turn all the way to the right to 180 seconds, and then the scroll wheel stops turning. It turns in the middle of those screens, but it won't let me turn beyond them. And here's another example, navigation settings. As you can see, I'm scrolling through the navigation settings, but when I reach the bottom of the menu, the wheel stops turning. I reach the top of the menu, and the wheel stops turning. So the wheel is programmed to know what each and every menu looks like and how far it can actually scroll up, down, side to side, whatever. And when it reaches the top of every individual menu, the wheel knows it's time to stop allowing them to scroll. And here's another incredible thing. On screens where the scroll wheel isn't applicable, it simply doesn't allow you to turn it at all. Here I go into the phone menu. The phone's not connected, so you can't do anything, and the scroll wheel is fixed. You can't turn it. But I go back into the map, and then once again, I can move it around to zoom in and out on the map until it reaches its limitations. Next up, we move on to my next favorite quirk, and that is what Bentley did with the B logos. Now, I'm around behind the car, and you see how there's no trunk popper back here? There's no little thing you put your hand under, and it pops open the trunk? Well, actually, there is. It's the B logo. You push it, and now the trunk is unlatched, so I can open it right up. Close it, it's closed. Push the B and it pops open. That's pretty cool. But it's nowhere near as cool as what happens up here. Now, to open the hood, it's pretty standard. There's a little handle in the driver's footwell. You pull it and the hood unlatches. But when you come up here, you're looking for the hood latch and you can't find it. There isn't one. Well, actually, there is, and it's the little B in the Bentley logo. You pull it, that unlatches the hood, and you can lift it up. And that is pretty cool. Now, the way it works is, when you pull the handle in the driver's footwell, it releases the B and moves forward so that you have enough room, you can pull it up and then open the hood. In normal driving, the B is just flat, like a traditional Bentley logo. But maybe the most interesting B logo of all comes in the interior, and specifically on the shifter. At the top of the shifter, there is the Bentley B, and that is the little button you press in order to shift between gears, park, reverse, neutral, and drive. However, if you want to put the car in sport mode or manual mode, you move it over from drive, and the little B retreats into the shifter, because then you don't need it anymore. You can just push the shift lever up and down to switch between gears. When you move it back over to drive, the button pops back up so you can use it to shift back into park or reverse. That is really good attention to detail from Bentley, and it's a cool way to make the shift button a little bit more than a regular shift button. Now, beyond the B logos, one of the interesting things about this particular car we must discuss in the interior is the fact that everything is blue. And I seriously mean everything is blue. The seats are blue, pretty standard. The steering wheel is blue, getting unusual. The carpets are blue. The center console, the dashboard, all blue. But there are some really crazy things in this car that are blue. The seat belts are blue. That's not all that unusual, but the seat belt latch is also blue. And the little dot that makes sure the seat belt latch stays within reach is also blue. Even the seat belt buckle in this car is blue. In fact, they went so far to create the ultra blue interior that the sun visor is blue and the little cover over the sun visor mirror is blue. They wanted nothing spared if you wanted to get a very blue interior, which the owner of this car clearly did. Next, I'm going to move on to some of the other interesting items in the interior, some of which are very interesting. I'm going to start in the middle with the spoiler control. Now, this must have been one of the first electronically adjustable spoilers you could adjust with a little button, and it operates a little strangely. If you push the button to raise the spoiler right here in the middle, the spoiler goes up and back, and that's pretty standard. But if you push the button to lower the spoiler, it doesn't just whirr down. Instead, take a look at what happens. It sort of goes down in steps. And in fact, you have to hold the button and watch in the back to see the spoiler go down in each individual step until it is flush with the trunk. Once again, it is not exactly the most graceful spoiler operation, but back in 2004, 2005, I guess that was better than nothing. And next we move on to the button next to the spoiler. That would be the suspension button. It allowed you to change the suspension from sporty to comfort. The thing I like about the suspension button is when you press it, you look on the infotainment system, and as you go through the suspension options, the graphic becomes like beefier or less beefy depending on which suspension setting you choose. It's kind of funny to look at. While cars today would just say comfort or normal or sport, the Continental GT actually shows the suspension getting thicker or thinner depending on which setting you choose. Now, next to the suspension, the spoiler control, you will find the ashtray, which looks like a fairly standard ashtray, except when you open it, you can't actually pull it out in order to dump the ashes, which seems unusual. That's a pretty obvious thing of every ashtray. But there's a secret to it. Once it's open, if you push back on the lid, the ashtray is then presented to you and you can go and dump it. Leave it to the Bentley Continental GT to have an Easter egg that overcomplicates simply removing the ashtray to dispose of your cigarette ashes. Now, next we move on to the center armrest in this vehicle, which is rather unusual. First off, there are two of them. There's one on the driver's side and one on the passenger side, which seems standard, except you can open them, which is a little bit unusual. Inside the driver's side center armrest, there was a phone that was delivered new with this car, an old school phone that you could use to make calls or whatever. It was integrated into the infotainment system. Inside the passenger side, there was a separate handset, and it was called the privacy handset. You press this little silver button and then the privacy handset is delivered to you very nicely, and you can see it has the little Bentley logo on it. The theory here was that if you wanted to talk on a more private call as the driver, you could pick up the privacy handset and then it wouldn't go through the speakers anymore. It was just on your handset, so your passenger couldn't hear what the other person on the phone was saying. The owner's manual shows how it would have looked if the phone had been in place along with the privacy handset. Now, another interesting thing about these center armrests is that they are adjustable. If you don't like it in this position, you can move it up, and now it's in this position, and it's locked in place. Or you can move it higher, and now it's in this position, and it's locked in place. And if you want it to go back down, you move it all the way up, and then you can put it all the way back down. And both armrests do that. The passenger side can also be put up or all the way back down, and then it can go back down. It's sort of an ingenious solution. And if you don't want the armrests at all, you can put them both up and then they're gone out of your hair, and you have access to a hidden storage compartment. You open up this little storage compartment and you will see that inside it there is this weird oval shaped thing, which isn't a cup holder. I'm not exactly sure what oval shaped container it was going to hold, but nonetheless, it is in there, a secret to any Bentley Continental GT owners who have never put up their armrests. Next up, moving on to a couple of other interesting items here in the center console, one of which is this button marked Global Close. Now, in later Continental GT models, this became the engine start stop button, but in the first couple of years, you actually had to insert the key to the left of the steering wheel, and Global Close was the Global Close button. So what exactly does it do? Well, if you're in the car, you can press a little button on the door panel to lock or unlock the doors. But if you press Global Close, not only will it lock the doors, but it will also roll up all the windows. So if you're driving along with the doors unlocked and the windows down and you decide you want everything to be shut up and locked, you press Global Close and everything locks, the windows go up with the push of one single button. I'm not sure why anybody would want that, but Bentley gave it to you anyway. The other interesting thing here in the center console is the heated seat controls. This car doesn't have cooled seats, but it does offer heated seats with 6 different levels of heating. I always find this absolutely hilarious. Does Bentley think that their customer can tell the difference between level 4 seat heating and level 5 seat heating? Oh, it just isn't quite warm enough. Let's move it up 1, but not move it up 2. That would be too warm. I think Bentley overestimates just how sensitive the butts of their customers actually are. Next up, a few other interesting items throughout the interior, one of which is the paddle shifters. Now, I love the fact that the paddle shifters in this car are mounted on the steering column. That way you always know where the paddles are when you're turning the wheel. So if you're mid-cornering, you know exactly where your paddle is so you can shift. Usually only the top-end sports cars have that feature. The problem in this car, though, is when you go to put on your left turn signal, that's where the shift paddle is. In fact, they move the turn signals down to sort of the bottom of the steering wheel. So when you go to put on the turn signal, you have to kind of move your hand down to the bottom in order to avoid hitting the shift paddle. And I guess now we see the problem with putting the paddles on the column. Next up, we move on to the door panel, and specifically the power window controls. This car, even though it only has 2 doors, has 4 power windows because the back ones roll down. And here is something incredible. This car has individual rear window locks. So if you're the driver and you got 2 people in back and you're annoyed with one of them rolling up and down their window and annoying you, you can lock one window only and leave the other one available to be rolled up and down. Usually in a car, you press one single window lock button and it locks out all the windows, but in this car, you can choose which window you want to lock out. Also interesting, in that little window control bank, you will see there's a control for the trunk and the fuel door, and they have the exact same size and shape as the window controls, this nice silver finish. The interesting thing about that is usually the trunk and the fuel door are like little handles that you pull, they're plastic, they're crappy, but in this car, they're very nice and well-appointed, just like everything in this interior. And speaking of nice and well-appointed, I have to draw your attention to the gauge cluster dimmer switch. Now, if you look to the left of the steering wheel, you can see it there. It just looks like a standard button up and down, but the interesting thing is these buttons are actually tilted when you press them. If you're increasing the gauge cluster brightness, it's tilted up, and if you're decreasing it, it's tilted down. Now, Bentley could have just made these regular buttons that push in, but instead they gave them just a little tilt so you could feel exactly what you were pushing. That is impressive attention to detail. Less impressive attention to detail is the key for this car, which is just a Volkswagen Audi key from this time period, except with a Bentley logo on the back. This is the same key you got if you bought a new Beetle from the Volkswagen dealership for $19,500 with hubcaps, and for some reason they decided that it was nice enough to be in the Bentley. It actually surprises me considering some of the other high-end touches and finishes that this car has. Next up, we move on to the glove box, which is where you'll find the owner's manual and various other interesting things, my favorite of which is the Bentley accessories catalog. There are quite a few unusual accessories in here, starting with snow chains. You could get Bentley branded snow chains for your Continental GT if you planned to do some serious winter driving. But that isn't my favorite Bentley accessory. Next, we move on to the hazard and emergency warning light kit, which doesn't come with a warning triangle, but rather something better, these little warning dots you can put on the road that give off light. You can see the dots being demonstrated to the left. Who needs a warning triangle when you have cool Bentley dots? And next up, Bentley will sell you car bubbles. In fact, they'll sell you two of them. There's one on the left that's a square, and the one on the right is called the Carcoon, which I guess is a play on cocoon for your car, so it's a carcoon. And you can buy that straight from the Bentley accessories catalog. But my favorite Bentley item is this. It's these switch cufflinks. They are cufflinks designed to mimic that center switch that you can use to change around the infotainment screen so that you always have a reminder of your well-engineered center switch whenever you're dressing up for a formal function. Next up, moving on to the roadside assistance pamphlet. First, I want to direct your attention to the fact that it has a very cool cover. The cover has a cutout for the Bentley logo, which is actually on the first page. I'm far more amused by this than I probably should be. Anyway, moving on to the roadside assistance, it goes through towing and tire changing and all that, and then it ends by saying that roadside assistance reimbursement will be paid in the currency of the country where you broke down. So, if you're driving your Bentley through Mexico and you break down and you need like trip reimbursement or a night in a hotel, they will be reimbursing you in pesos. Something to keep in mind if you're going to drive your Bentley in a foreign country. Next up, moving on to the old school infotainment system, there are a couple of interesting items worth noting beyond that center dial that controls everything. One of which is, if you press info, it tells you all the info you need to know, your direction of travel, the street you're on, even your coordinates, but it also says Bentley GT infotainment system, telling you even the most basic thing in case you really need info. What am I driving? What is this? Another interesting item in the infotainment system, if you press trip, it'll show you trip statistics. Now, one screen will show you trip statistics since you last turned on the car on your current drive, but another shows long-term statistics, basically since you last reset the system. Now, the interesting thing about the long-term statistics here is that it shows the last 49 miles of driving, this car got 7.6 miles per gallon, which is not exactly exemplary. Also, I find it interesting, if you go into infotainment settings, it allows you to choose the date. You can go in and you can change the day, month, and year. The weird thing about the year is that it even allows you to choose dates all the way back to 2000, even though this is a 2005 model, so it never would have been 2000. It was built after that, but nonetheless, you can make it 2000 if you want to go back even further than your Bentley while you're driving this car. Now, next up, I'm going to move on to climbing into the back. Now, this car has back seats, and as I often do, I'm going to climb into them, which is actually a fairly simple process. First, you pull up this silver latch, which sort of moves the seat forward, and then you just push the seat back, and the seat is all the way forward, and now you can climb in, which I will now attempt to do. Ah, and now I'm in the back of the Continental GT. Now, obviously, it's small back here. It was designed for occasional use, and there are a couple of interesting quirks in the back, one of which is the rear floor mat, which is absolutely hilarious. It's like the smallest rear floor mat I've ever seen. It's basically the size of an iPad, but they put it back here because it's Bentley, and that's what they gotta do. Other interesting items in the back are just how much it mimics the front. For example, you have another ashtray back here, identical to the front ashtray, and once again, if you push the lid, it will present the ashtray for you so you can dispose of its contents. Also back here is another storage compartment that you can roll the top down, and you can see another plastic oval inside the storage compartment to carry your oval-shaped drinks. The back seat even has the same overhead lighting area as the front seat, finished in wood with individual map lights for each rear seat, even though this is barely ever going to be used. Now, there are a few other interesting items in the back seat besides just mimicking the front seat, one of which is the fact that everything back back here remains blue. Even the tiny little rear seat speaker covers, they're like 2 inches in diameter, and even they are blue to make sure that every detail in this interior is blue. Also worth noting and interesting back here is the rear armrest. You release it and then it sort of slowly and automatically unfurls itself so you can place your arm on it. Behind the center armrest, why, there's a blue piece of leather, of course. Why wouldn't there be? So even if your center armrest is down, you can still gaze at your blue interior. Now, if you take that blue piece of leather down, you will find the trunk pass through in case you want to carry skis or some other long item in your Bentley. You'll see that trunk pass-through lid even has a leather handle on it. Every detail is paid attention to, although that handle is black, not blue. For shame. Another interesting item I like back here is the coat hangers. They're silver, they're mounted on the ceiling. You pull them and they just pop out, and they're very solid feeling. They're probably the most solid feeling coat hangers I've ever experienced. I would expect no less from Bentley. Next, we move on to a couple of interesting items on the outside of the car, a couple of which are in the mirror. One of which is the mirror turn signal. Now, a lot of cars have mirror turn signals mounted on the outside of the car, but this one is especially unusual. When you look at it from one angle, it looks like 5 turn signal bulbs, but as you walk slowly around towards the back of the car, it sort of melds into one single turn signal, which is a neat effect. Also unusual on this mirror is the fact that the entire mirror is sort of rimmed in chrome, which is something you don't see in any other car. It's just like the windows on the outside, the bright work. I guess it's supposed to give the mirror sort of a classier appearance. Next, we move on to the back of the car. Now, if you look in the taillights, you can see it has these 2 giant LED ovals that turn on when the brake lights are on. They're huge. Interestingly, however, when you put on the turn signal, it's just a regular old bulb down here. Later, Bentley turned one of these into the turn signal, but initially when this car came out, they couldn't figure it out, or they didn't do it for whatever reason, and so the turn signal is just a normal old boring bulb. And for our final act on the exterior of this car, we have to see the headlight washers. Now, before I came and picked this car up, it was beautifully detailed by Chaz at Details at the Ranch here in Rancho Santa Fe. It is beautiful. I feel bad about ruining his handiwork, but well, not that bad. Let's take a look. So those are all the quirks and features of the 05 Continental GT. Now it's time for the fun part. I'm gonna get behind the wheel and drive it. All right, driving the Continental GT. Now the first thing I notice when I climb inside this car is it is very blue. And I mean very blue. But actually, I kind of like that. It matches the exterior, obviously. And if you want like a flamboyant exterior color like that, why not bring it into the interior? It's cool. So many of these cars that I film are gray, black, silver. And this is at least a little bit more unique. I've driven a ton of these. And one of the things I remember about driving this car is the speed is absolutely incredible. And so now I will floor it. God. The thing about these Bentleys that's so amazing is they don't build power like so many other cars. I mentioned this in my Bentayga review like 2 years ago. They don't build power like most other cars. It just sort of, it isn't like a hammer that hits you right away. It just sort of increases and increases and increases. It feels like a jet plane taking off. These things are really, really incredible in terms of the way that they build power. They feel very fast, but they don't hit you like an STI or a GTR or something where it's like, oh my God. The thing about this car is a lot of the tech has aged. You know, the infotainment system, the navigation is a joke, whatever. But what hasn't aged, 2 things. Number one, the performance is still quite impressive. 15 years ago, it was impressive. It is still impressive today. The performance is still like, whoa, I can't believe it's that fast. The other thing that hasn't aged is the materials quality is still absolutely excellent. No, it doesn't have a touchscreen. It doesn't have the nicest whatever in terms of modern tech. But everything that was stitched together so beautiful 15 years ago is still stitched together beautifully. Everything looks wonderful. And it's funny because I'm driving this thing. It's a 13-year-old car. It's got 30,000 miles. It feels still very high quality. And not high quality in a, oh, this was nice for a 15-year-old car kind of way. The stitching is excellent. Nothing is creaking. Nothing is rattling, which is unusual when you drive a car of this age. Everything still feels as much a luxury car car as you would expect it to. One thing I always loved about this car is the way that it sounds. It doesn't sound like a sports car, but it also doesn't sound like a luxury car. It has sort of this deep kind of sound to it that's muted, but just enough that you know it's like, this is a serious performance car. In terms of handling, I've always been impressed by this car. It handles quite well for a vehicle of its size. The steering is very light, like a luxury car. This was not designed to be a sports car at all. However, it's very sharp, so it's a very light steering feel. And there's a little vagueness in terms of on-center. However, when you actually are going into a corner or whatever, the steering is quite sharp. This is a wide car, it has big wide tires, and it actually feels pretty planted to the ground. It feels like a sporty luxury car. Bentley, now it's getting more common that luxury cars are also sporty cars. But back then, Bentley forged this great middle ground between sporty cars and luxury cars that hadn't really been done all that much until then, and it's still quite an impressive car to drive today. And so that's the 2005 Bentley Continental GT. I know reliability is a concern for this car. After all, it's a German-English car with a twin-turbocharged 12-cylinder engine and a lot of electronics. But when it's working, it is very impressive. It is an ultra-high-end luxury car. It's a really fast sports car, and it's a relatively affordable used car all rolled into one. In the end, this is probably the most car you can buy for 55 grand when it's working. Anyway, now it's time to give it a Doug score. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Continental GT is handsome, it's aged very well, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Acceleration is brisk, it does 0 to 60 in 4.6 seconds, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Handling is surprisingly sharp given its size, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Fun factor is better than you'd think. This car is a blast to drive, and it's more exciting than you'd ever expect just from looking at it. Still, at its core, it's an automatic transmission luxury car, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Cool factor is only a bit above average. These have gotten very common, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Added up, the weekend score is 31 out of 50, which is respectable for a car like this. Next up are the daily categories, starting with features. This car was loaded 13 years ago, but it's a good example of how these things can age and they're no longer very cutting edge. By modern standards, it gets only a 4 out of 10. Comfort hasn't aged, though. This car is still a tremendously comfortable place to spend time, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Quality is good. The interior quality is amazing, but reliability is a huge concern, and because of that, it can only get a 7 out of 10. Practicality is fine for a coupe, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Finally, there's value. If this was reliable, it would get a 10, but if it was reliable, it would probably not be so cheap. As it stands, it's a lot of car for the money if you can afford to keep it going, and it gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 30 out of 50. Add it up, and the Doug score is 61 out of 100, which places it about in the middle of other luxury-ish coupes. You can see it also trounces the Volkswagen Phaeton W12, which shares a lot of components with the Continental GT. Thank you.